a meeting now.
Okay, Ms. Voss, you may proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor. When we were discussing parental conflicts that affect the children, regarding their physical health, did you have any concerns about Rice's physical health? As a result?
Around the conflict?
Yeah.
Yes.
And specifically?
Attempting to get Chloe into the Emily program because of her overeating, and we were trying to see if she had a eating disorder. And the conflict arose around the way the order from the court was put in place that Ms. Voss can't attend appointments in, with the children. And the way that the Emily program was trying...
Objection narrative, it was a pretty limited yes or no sort of thing.
It wasn't. You said why. You may proceed.
Thank you.
And with the Emily program wanting to have scheduled appointments with Chloe during your visitation, it was not able to occur. Whether it be for your reasons or the reasons of the courts being having the order in place. However, the conflict, that was part of the conflict caused my daughter to have issues with her, the Emily program system, because of this conflict.
And you keep referring to Rice as my daughter, your daughter, rather. Is Rice not our daughter?
Rice is our daughter.
And so when you continue to refer to the children as my children, my daughter, my son, you're aware that I've raised an objection to how that feels exclusionary to me. Are you? You're aware of that?
If it makes you feel like it's exclusionary,
yes.
Because I say my child?
Yes. When I'm present and we're talking, are you aware that I've raised objection to that?
Okay, you've raised an objection to that.
Were you aware that I've previously raised an objection to that?
The way I talk is the way I talk. I understand you can make objections to the way I talk, but I just speak the way I speak.
Again, let me rephrase the question. Were you aware prior to trial commencing that I objected to your use of...
Well, let me get this straight. I'm responsible for me, not you.
Your Honor, the witness isn't answering the question.
You should ask the question, Mr. Knight.
Can you repeat the question?
Were you aware prior to trial commencing that I object to your referring to Hayden and Rice as your children, my daughter and my son?
I said yes.
Oh. And so you're aware and you continue to do that?
Yes.
And so when Rice expresses they prefer the name Rice instead of being called Chloe or with the pronouns they, them, instead of daughter, she or her, does their preference make an impact on your language or word choice?
I call Chloe Rice. I call Chloe them, they. I call Chloe Chloe. I speak to my daughter so that I can communicate with her.
Let's see, let's move on to, regarding the children's education, did you have concern about...
Ms. Voss, you'll have to speak up again, okay?
I apologize. Regarding the children's education, did you have any concerns about the children's grades?
Yes.
What about the fact that there is no IEP in place for either of the children?
Considering that I have a team at the school to go over all of the needs for the children, we have got all the documentation in place that we feel is necessary at this time.
So you're not concerned about an IEP?
Not at this time.
Thank you. What about the children's ability to navigate school remotely through online platforms? Do you have any concern about?
Yeah, I'd like them to be able to do that.
And do you have concern that they haven't been able to do that?
I have concerns with this conflict causing issues with their abilities to be able to do that, yes.
And so the school health plans.
The which health plan?
The school health plans. Who was responsible for getting those plans in place so that the children could attend school in person the 21-22 school year, this school year?
Since the conflict between you and I was going on and you kept interfering with the medications and doctor's appointments, I gave permission to the school district to go directly to the doctors and providers so that they wouldn't get any conflicting information. And then after they got that, I sat down with them to confirm if it was the proper stuff that our doctors wanted done, and then we implemented it.
And so the children missed the first 3 weeks of the school year, and that would be then the nurse's responsibility?
No, it wouldn't. It would be the parents' responsibility to not be having conflict and going to court continuously so that the parents can concentrate on the well-being of the children.
So it's my fault?
It's the parents.
Okay. And so you indicated previously regarding there was a complaint made to the school board in 2018 regarding harassment, intimidation, and bullying. And as I recall, you stated something to the effect that I didn't have a right to bring that complaint to the school board. Is that your testimony?
I didn't testify that. You're trying to put words in my mouth.
I'm
not understanding where you're coming from that.
Okay.
I don't understand where I've supposedly made this statement at.
When you were questioning, and I can't recall which witness, do you feel that I had a right to bring Hayden to the school board and make the HIV, the harassment, intimidation, and bullying complaint against school staff?
No, I did not believe you had a right to take our child and use him as a tool to go in front of the school board to try to make the school board make Mr. Knight do what you wanted him to do. No, I did not agree with that at all.
Are you aware that the Washington Administrative Code requires each school district to allow anyone to make or file complaints? They don't have to be a parent?
No, I was not aware of that.
Okay. And just for reference, that's WAC 392.
If you have a question, you can ask the question.
Okay. I will testify later. Would you agree that co-parenting is not possible between us?
Oh, yes. I would definitely agree to that.
And I assume from your statements thus far that my mental health is the primary cause of that?
I am not sure exactly what the reasoning is for it, but your mental health seems to be one of the issues, yeah. Hold on, wait a minute. Let me rephrase that. I do not believe you have a mental illness. I believe you have a disorder.
And which disorder is that?
I am not a psychiatrist to actually put a name on it, but you have a disorder.
And who do you think would be qualified to determine
this? Dr. McCollum.
And are you aware that he's retired?
Say that a little bit louder.
I'm sorry, are you aware that he's retired?
Seems I heard something that he has retired, yeah.
So, aside from Dr. McCollum, is there anyone that would be capable of identifying this disorder that you see?
Dr. Langer stated that disorders are a lifetime thing. Only traits can go away. You have been diagnosed as with a disorder. You will have that disorder. You can do therapy to get rid of the traits and make it better, but you will continuously have that disorder. That is the fact of psychology whenever you're diagnosed with a disorder.
So we've kind of identified some large groups that I'd like to dive into a little bit deeper. So litigation is kind of the first area, and let's see. The amended petition alleges Mr. Knight physically, mentally, and emotionally abuses and neglects the children to get back at me, among other things. And so with litigation, actually, let me back up. Our parenting plan is fairly specific about how to avoid litigation, is it not, regarding mediation?
It states that there's an opportunity for mediation, yes.
Okay. And so some of these conflicts that we've had, do you think could have been perhaps resolved through mediation rather than filing a petition to modify the parenting plan?
Not without you having some sort of personality treatment because of your projection of your fears onto me, I cannot sit down and come to an agreement with you because you take it out of context.
So you don't feel mediation's appropriate?
No, ma'am.
And so our current parenting plan requires that, and you disagreed with that requirement. When I requested mediation on 9/15 of 2018, and you refused?
We have done numerous mediations in the past. None of them were prosperous at all. There is absolutely no reason to continue mediation. I do not want to even speak to you after out of sight of court.
I'd like to see Exhibit 14. Do you recognize that?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is that not
the objection, Your Honor? A motion in limine on that.
Okay. So let's hear the question first. Do you recognize this? And then I didn't think I heard the question. I don't think you completed the question. So go ahead and make a question. I'll maintain your objection. Go ahead.
The question was simply, do you recognize this document?
I'm going to, at this juncture, go ahead. I'm going to hold the objection in advance. You answered that question. She asked if you recognize the document. I'll allow her to answer that question.
I said yes.
I didn't hear that. I apologize. And so you just testified that we've never had a mediation agreement.
Objection, Your Honor. This is limine. This was from 2014.
For limited scope, it's being asked. It's the follow-up on a previous answer. I think I'll allow the question and deny the objection on this limited scope.
You just testified that we've had no mediation agreements in the past, correct?
I said none that panned out. None that was beneficial to this system. None that helped our case. It does not pan out for us to sit down and do this.
And so when you testified that we had no mediation agreements, you expected the court to use the motion in limine to exclude this evidence. Is that correct?
No, ma'am. I'm using the motion of limine because I'm tired of litigating over stuff that's, this here's what, 8 years old? That we are here specifically for something that you have created and started and put an amended in. That's why we're here. If any of this mediation should have ever worked, we wouldn't be here.
It's non-responsive, sustained.
Thank you. And do you recall when Dr. Abdullah testified that things were much better when we were on the same page? When we first started seeing Dr. Abdullah in 2014?
when you had me so submissive because of your court
it's
attacks.
It's a yes or no question. Do you recall the
no,
testimony?
No, I don't.
Do you recall that things were easier?
No, I don't.
And this mediation agreement
never succeeded.
Wait till the question's asked. Go ahead.
Was specifically related to Hayden's management of Hayden's medical care. Is that correct?
I'm not testifying
to
that.
No more. Hold it. I allowed it for limited scope, and that limited scope was that there was a mediation agreement. Now you're going into the content of it. I'm going to sustain the objection.
I'm sorry, Your Honor. Can I pursue questions about the children's medical health and this being a foundational
post 2017?
Change of circumstances was something that the court specifically included in the original findings, in that I can't demonstrate a change of circumstances unless we establish what the circumstance was prior to 2017. And agreed diet, agreed management of the children's health, and Mr. Knight's deviation from all of those agreements is the basis of that case. If the court's not going to include...
But what is the base, what is the rationale to identify what the parties' agreements were when in 2017 he was given exclusive decision-making authority, which means he did not have to consider those agreements except as what was dictated by the court order in 2017, which has provisions about various care providers, I do recall that. But whether the parties had agreements prior to that time isn't of consequence to this court when the court order says he has sole and exclusive decision-making authority. So he could make his decisions as he felt based upon that order, recognizing, of course, that there were, I do recall that there was some reference to some care providers in there. I do recall that. But that's still our beginning point.
Okay. I'm sorry, I thought the best interest of the children was the center. Okay, my mistake.
No, you're not. It's not your mistake to think that, because ultimately any decision of this court is the best interest of the children. But the court is going to begin with the 2017 order from the court, which at that time that court felt was in the best interest of the children. We're not going to relitigate that.
So the statute on the abusive litigation or the abusive use of conflict includes abusive litigation and there was an order issued on 5/26/21, which cited CR 11A. Do you recall that?
No. I'm going to have to refresh my memory.
I'm afraid I don't have a copy of the order in front of me, but do you recall CR 11A? Court Rule 11A indicating that a party shall sign and date their pleadings?
You're going to have to refresh my memory.
I'm afraid I don't have a copy of that. Your exhibits 241, 243, 244, 245, and 246 are not signed or dated.
I heard the numbers, but after that you said what?
Are not signed or dated.
Okay.
Do you feel that...
What are you talking about? You're going to have to refresh my memory.
Your exhibits...
My exhibits? You haven't shown me nothing.
Wait a second. I don't have a question yet, so Mr. Knight, if you could just wait till we hear a question and then you can respond to the question. Go ahead, Ms. Voss.
These exhibits are not signed or dated. Can you explain that?
Can you show me what you're talking about?
Yes. Can we please have exhibit 241, 243? The question,
okay.
Why are you serving pleadings that are not signed or dated?
So which one are you talking about?
All of those in your hand.
Oh, all of these in my hand that have my signatures and dates on them? Right here? Ms. Voss, I don't know what your issue is. These all have my signatures and dates on them. Right here.
This is a fun game for you.
Let me see here. Let's go to the next one. Oh, there's a signed and dated there, too. How about on 246? Oh, made a mistake and did not sign 246.
Can you explain why the copy that you served me with is not signed or dated on 241?
Must have slipped my mind.
And so you provided the court with signed exhibits, and you provided me with unsigned exhibits. Must have slipped your mind.
Objection, Your Honor. What does the relevance have to our case here?
What's the relevance? Is
Along the lines of abusive litigation in CR 11, the failure to sign and date pleadings is a violation of CR 11, as I understand.
Your Honor, I'm going to have to object.
Stop. First of all, CR 11 are for pleadings that are filed with the court. A party who offers an exhibit is just that. It's an exhibit. It could also be a pleading, but it's not being filed with the court. It's being offered as an exhibit. Secondly, until the exhibit is admitted by the court, it's not even part of the court record. And then finally, while this court, during the COVID restrictions, where we were not having in-person contact, created orders which required parties to provide the other side with a copy of the exhibits ahead of time. It is not neither a court rule or a local court rule that requires that. The whole purpose of it was to provide the parties with an opportunity to be able to remotely testify and to have other witnesses remotely testify. So none of that is related to CR 11. So because of that, I will sustain the objection as not relevant.
I'd like to see exhibit 401, please. Do you believe that you've filed approximately 12 motions in the current case?
I responded to what you were doing.
So you didn't file any motions?
any motions that I filed was on response of what you had caused.
Let me ask the question again. Do you believe that you have filed approximately 12 motions?
Relevance.
What is the relevance?
Abusive litigation includes the filing and serving of motions, pleadings, etc. And so we've identified abusive litigation as something that harms the children. The statute includes abusive litigation under 26.51.020. To include claims, allegations, and other legal contentions made in the litigation are not warranted by existing law or by reasonable argument for the extension, modification, or reversal of existing law or the establishment of new law. And so if the amount of pleadings, the amount of litigation in this case is, I'm quantifying here, Mr. Knight has claimed that all of this litigation is my fault. And so he filed and served a number of motions, and so did I. I'm just quantifying that.
So relevance is based upon scintilla of evidence that may support any given claim, and so it does fit the relevance. I'll give latitude, so you can answer the question and overrule at this time.
I filed my motions in response to your actions.
The question again, for the third time, is about 12? Does that sound about right?
I filed my motions in reaction to your actions.
Objection, Your Honor, non-responsive.
It is non-responsive. Mr. Knight, answer the question, please.
Yes, I did file 12, it appears, in an attempt to right the wrong that you caused.
And 42% of those motions were denied in full?
Relevance, Your Honor.
Okay, what's the relevance on that?
I've just explained the relevance in the claims, allegations, and other contentions made are not warranted. And then further on in 26.51.020 under B, allegations and item 2, allegations and other factual contentions are made in the litigation are without the existence of evidentiary support. And so if Mr. Knight's motions, if he were unable to prevail, that suggests that his motions were without merit.
I'm going to have to object because Ms. Voss is the petitioner on this whole entire thing. She started it.
Okay. And so the issue is merit, without merit, as an offer of proof. Was there a finding in the court of no merit? I mean, that's where you're going.
That a motion was denied.
Denial does not mean without merit. So are you going to go to, I mean, it is relevant if you have motions that the court made a finding that the motion was brought without merit. That's different than a denial.
And I'm sorry, without having legal expertise and knowing the difference, I can't get there.
That gets you back to the CR 11 world, okay, without merit.
Without factual contentions made without the existence of evidentiary support. It brings us back to the interrogatories where there's no evidentiary support.
Okay.
And that's a separate issue. Like,
yeah, it
I'm
is
sorry,
a separate there. Issue, and you're mixing your concepts right there. If there is a finding without merit on by the court on litigation brought by Mr. Knight, I can accept that as being relevant. A denial, especially with regard to temporary orders, is not, it could be without merit, but unless there's a finding by the court that there is no merit, then it would not meet that, the definition that you just described about 2650.020. So based upon that, unless, and I don't want to presuppose that that's the case, Ms. Voss, but if that, you know, I don't, if you're going to get to some findings by this court that he brought motions without merit, then I'll allow you to continue this line of questioning. Outside of that, it would be, it is not relevant.
I'll withdraw that question and ask instead if Mr. Knight is aware of how many of my motions were fully granted.
Over 13 years, I don't know.
I meant specifically in this case.
As I stated to you before, this is your case. I am just trying to respond. I don't really know how many was actually granted.
Okay. You have made reports to medical professionals and child protective services of physical or mental abuse of the children, is that correct?
Refresh my memory, please.
Within, since the current parenting plan was put into place.
I don't mean to make things more stressful than they have to be, Ms. Voss, but I struggle with hearing you sometimes.
I apologize.
Okay.
I need the reminder and...
Okay.
No,
well,
no worries.
I don't like to keep on hounding you about it, but I do have a hard time hearing you sometimes.
If there were a flag that you could wave, that would be good too.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. So, do you recall making any reports to medical professionals and child protective services of physical or mental abuse of the children? Since the current parenting plan was put into place?
Can you refresh my memory?
I sure can.
Sure. Refresh my memory.
Can we see exhibit 46 and 340? And 27. before you answer that question, you asked previous questions about I haven't been found guilty of medical child abuse. Is that correct?
Pardon?
You asked prior witnesses about their whether or not they knew I had been found guilty of medical child abuse. Is that correct?
I did not.
And so on Exhibit 27, I believe it is page 6. Can you read 10.21?
Ms. Voss, did we already review this?
I know we've reviewed the exhibit in general. I can't recall if this particular item it was.
We did review this finding previously.
Okay.
And I can't recall who the witness was at the time, but it was brought up. I don't believe 27 was admitted. So if that's a direction you're going, then I'll allow the continuing the questions, but I just want to make sure that...
And it may have been 314.
This is one over with Dr. Langer.
Yeah, I think that's where it was. And it, and 314 has not been admitted either, but
so,
I do recall it was Dr. Langer. But
okay, so yes, I'd like to offer Exhibit 27.
Any objection to 27 be admitted?
No objection.
Okay, so... Exhibit number 27 is, okay, let's pause for a moment on this because, and I'm looking for someone to refresh my memory right now. When Dr. Langer was testifying with regard to this document, was he looking at 27 or was he looking at the 314?
I think it was the 314.
Thank you.
This
we
is
were,
the concern.
We were
court,
working out of hers. This is a. No, you did go into the box, didn't you?
Yeah.
I can't recall.
This is my concern, is that Dr. Langer testified to this document. If it was identified as 314, if this is reviewed, and again, record is always really important, if this
right.
is reviewed at a later date, there may not, it may be that. The review would be of an unadmitted document, and it would only be his testimony. However, if later on the document is admitted, then the review would be his testimony and the document. Okay, and so that's
right.
the distinction. If it, certainly we can enter 27 if that's your preference. However, there may be that disjunction.
I understand the concern, Your Honor, and I look back through my notes. It looks like I did request Exhibit 27.
Okay, very good.
I questioned him initially.
Okay, very good. So Exhibit number 27 is admitted.
And so it sounds like we previously established that the court did not find I had medically abused.
Right.
The children. Okay. I'm sorry for going back over something we've already done. And so, the next exhibit, 46. Recognize these? This exhibit?
Objection to date. But yes, I recognize them.
Well,
I believe these
like
were already submitted earlier. It's whenever Ms. Voss had an attorney. Under a different number.
And they were not admitted. as.
It's under the, when we were doing the counseling records.
Well, I mean, it's still dealing with it, but let's double check that we're not using another number for something that's already been admitted.
And the other record is 332.
Okay, thank you.
And I have no indication that it was offered or admitted.
And I would agree with that. Okay, so.
Okay.
And your objection was the.
Objection is limiting.
Okay, well, I do see that towards the end, we're in 2018.
And this was submitted under ER 904 to Mr. Knight as item number 24, and his only objection was to relevance.
Well, if it's complete, there's a few things in here that's very good for my case, but it's only if it's complete medical records.
And there was no objection to completeness.
Okay.
It was simply relevance.
And so, do you still wish to make an objection based upon relevance? And I'm sorry, are you offering this right now? Or do
I would like to.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you. I might have to force before the card.
Even though there's things in there that could benefit me, I'm still saying the lemony on the date and stuff. We have more current counseling issues and stuff. Going on. This would be a backdoor. She's trying to ask me a question about one thing in here to try to get this entire thing in.
Well, so response on relevance.
Thank you, Your Honor. Counseling records for Rice from predating are the signing of the parenting plan. It actually involves how the impact of litigation throughout, because the trial started in, you know, February, March of 2017, and the orders weren't actually signed until September. So this record actually gives the court a unique opportunity to see the impact of litigation on this child, spanning, you know, at the beginning of trial through well beyond the signing of the parenting plan. And it's certainly relevant in that my question was related to false reports by Mr. Knight to providers, and this is chock full of them.
The court's going to find that they are relevant. Court's going to further find that these are the type of documents that are authorized by ER 904, and with relevance being the objection in the 904 objection, the court is going to admit petitioner's exhibit number 46.
I have a question of completeness.
Well, and again, that gets back to your objection for the 904. To preserve that. Let me double check the rule. I don't think it was preserved.
I
And I was just looking at the rule and the comments on the rule, and sort of everybody understands that the court generally looks at the Teglin version of the rules of evidence, which go into very detail and depth analysis of each of the rules. It's a leading treatise on this issue. And one thing that is pointed out by the cases, and specifically Miller versus Arctic Alaska Fisheries Corporation, 133 Washington 2nd, 250, 1997 case, is the court recognizes that at the time that the objections are made, it may not be known for what purpose that the document is being offered for. Therefore, the objection may not be a complete objection, and the court can consider additional arguments as long as it's been objected to, knowing what is known at the time. Okay, that's basically it in a nutshell. I'll accept Mr. Knight's objection as under 904, because he would not have known at the time that the 904 for what purpose the exhibit would have been offered for. What Mr. Knight is now indicating is that this is an incomplete document and under the rule of completeness should not be allowed. And a person would not have the knowledge to make an objection based upon completeness until it is offered and the relevance is objected to. And then there is a basis. So the court's finding it's relevant. The court, on the rule of completeness then, Mr. Knight is able to require Ms. Voss to provide the missing documents, which I'm anticipating are the balance of the medical records from, is it BHR? BHR, and I don't know if they are even missing.
I'm not even sure if they're missing. That's okay. My whole point. There's nobody here to verify this is a complete document.
Well, it's a rule of completeness requires you to be able to say, you're missing the following, you need to and put it in there. Okay, and I recognize that you don't know what the original looks like, but you've had, under 904, you've had this submission. So I can't grant a motion based upon lack of completeness until someone tells me what is incomplete.
Okay, so Mr. Knight, basically going on under the basis that every time Ms. Voss files anything, she always retracts or takes stuff out. Okay. So
that doesn't
well,
get
I have
there.
A few things in my stuff here that if we don't show up in, shows up in here, then it's not complete.
At this point, you're anticipating it's not complete, but I don't have any indication that that's the case.
Okay, well,
okay. So
I got some evidence here that it's not going to look good for her, and if that's not in there, then that's not going to look good for her either. So.
Okay, so the underlying basis for a objection based upon completeness has not been met, so the court is admitting Exhibit 46.
And so if you turn to page 10 of 68?
Exhibit 46.
I'm sorry, yes. Mm-hmm. Exhibit 46, ER 904, number one, item 24, page 10 of 68. And about two-thirds of the way down the page, it says presenting problem or current circumstances.
Which page is that again?
10 of 68.
Okay. Okay.
And about two-thirds of the way down the page, it says presenting problem, current circumstances. Can you please read that?
Presenting problem, current circumstances. Bobby, dad reports that he got full custody of Chloe due to medical child abuse by the Angela Vass. Bobby reports that he got full custody of Chloe 18 months. Bobby had full custody initially, then it went 50-50. Now it's full custody again. Chloe is reportedly having emotional outbursts and behaviors.
And throughout all of these records, at each if we go all the way back to page 54 of 68.
I'm sorry, what page was that again?
54 of 68.
Thank you.
That same citation occurs, does it not?
I don't know. You're going to have to point it out to me.
Note addresses which treatment plan problem towards the bottom.
Well, Ms. Voss, the custody issue that we were going
Objection,
through CPS for was for medical child abuse, and since
pause.
The...
Pause for a moment. There's an objection as it being argumentative. I'll sustain the objection. Answer the question, and if you would just restate the question, Ms. Voss, so I'll make sure that I understand it.
Thank you, Your Honor. That same report occurs here. Is that correct?
That's what they have notated.
Okay, and so this record is dated 2/7 of 2018, is that correct?
No, it says 2/8 of 18.
Where do you see that?
We're looking at page 54 of 88, correct?
Correct.
At the top of it, it says submitted 2/8 of 18.
Okay. I was looking at date of service
at
2/7.
Further, 2/6 of 17. Okay. It's
okay.
Covered up.
All right. And so, well after the court found that I did not medically abuse the children, why is this report still being made to service providers?
Why do you continuously tell people that I abuse the children?
Objection, unresponsive.
It is unresponsive, so I'll sustain the objection and ask the question one more time.
I have a right to my perspective. That's to the answer.
You understood the question, so, okay.
Thank you, Your Honor. And so you feel you have a right to report to the children's providers that I abused the children, even though I didn't?
I have a right to report to the medical providers what I have seen you do to the children, which is true, and it pertained to medical child abuse.
And so the court's findings that
doesn't change what I've seen.
Okay, so you're not impacted by what the court finds?
Well, obviously you're not impacted. You didn't follow the court rules. You didn't follow the order.
Objection,
to do...
Objection, non-responsive.
That is true. That was not... I will sustain the objection.
And so the next record, the Consejo records for Hayden, Exhibit 340.
They have been admitted.
Yes.
Do you already have that, Mr. Knight?
Which one?
340.
340, yes, it's right here.
So this record indicates that you made the same report, similar report to Consejo, is that correct?
Ms. Voss, I feel that you did medical child abuse, and I can speak to people however I choose to about it.
Okay. So that would be a yes?
I would say it was a yes.
Okay. And you made similar reports to Child Protective Services?
Yes, I did.
Let's see, Exhibit 17. What impact do you think it has on the children's service providers to hear your repeated reports that I'm abusing the children?
About as much as them hearing you saying I'm abusing the children?
Objection, unresponsive.
Actually, I do think it was responsive. I'll overrule the objection. It may not be complete, but it's responsive.
Do you feel that the children's providers take your reports seriously?
I believe that the providers are professional people, and they take the documentation they receive and they implement it in the way that was needed for the benefit of the children's care.
Objection, non-responsive. The question is, do they take the information from you seriously?
I can only assume if they're taking it seriously or if they think it's a joke. I don't know.
And I think he did follow up with a responsive answer.
Okay. I agree. And so Exhibit 17 includes reports by you to Child Protective Services.
Objection, Your Honor. This is under limine. It is from 2009. Are we just going to dismiss it on medical or what?
If you look further back into Exhibit 17, you will note it includes records intakes from 2009, 2010, 2014, 2020.
Okay, so let's deal with those portions of the record that are prior to 2017 as an offer of proof. Why should the court consider those records based upon the court's prior ruling?
The certified letter dated 7/23/2020 references intake number 397-5193.
In which page are you on?
The certified letter, I believe, is the last page. I'm sorry, I heard 929 and I'm trying to find.
At the very last page, it says 929.
29 of 29.
I'm not sure if I said it right, but yes. Okay. And
so
What does this refer to?
So that refers to the intake 297-5193, which is dated from 2014. It's on page 24. Oh, wait, it begins. There are many phone calls. It begins on page 19.
Okay, so this refers back to a report of in 2014, is that correct?
Correct. It
okay,
was the
so
basis for the dependency.
I still have the same question then.
Okay, so in July of 2020, the department finally understood that the valid findings of abuse were not valid. They were unfounded.
Okay, and so what is the relevance of that post-2017?
Mr. Knight is still going around to providers claiming I medically abused the children. The court's already found, the court found that I didn't, and now CPS, or Children's Administration, recognizes that I didn't. It doesn't affect his opinion, but he's still reporting it. And false allegations of abuse do fall within I believe it's RCW 26.51.020.
Okay. So in order
so
to wait, stop, sir. This document to be relevant based upon things he may have told other people, you need to lay further foundation with this witness.
I'm not going to instruct you any further than that.
But you have not laid proper foundation for that to occur.
And I had attempted to offer the document. Can I talk to Mr. Knight about the document without it having... I'm sorry, I can't make a step without an objection. This is really challenging.
And evidence rules are really challenging, so... As in any evidence that's not admitted from the court or with the court, you are able to take that evidence, that document, show it to a witness, and ask general questions without getting into the basic or the substance of the document. General questions without the specific substances of the document. Okay, and you can do that. When you start getting into the details and the substances of the document, that is where that line gets drawn, okay? And you are able to lay foundation by doing that, okay? So the objections on the in limine issue, okay? This is all prior to 2017. It's precluded in some situations, majority of situations. You're trying to get beyond that. So his objection is not on an evidentiary issue. The rules of evidence is based upon the motion in limine. Okay. So you can allow you to continue to try to lay foundation in order to get to the point where you can ask this to be offered up and to address the in limine. Okay. But you still have to lay foundation.
Thank you, Your Honor. And so what I wanted to ask initially was about the reports that you made in 2020 to establish a foundation, did you make further reports to Child Protective Services claiming that I had abused the children?
Refresh my memory. Do you have a documentation put in front of me?
I do. It is in your hand.
And
you refer to the page.
It is page 26 of
29. Can you rephrase your question again?
Do you recall making reports to Child Protective Services after the current parenting plan was put into place about my medically abusing or abusing or neglecting the children?
If you're referring to this intake from a report from CPS, I reported to CPS that I had gotten a call from the primary doctor because my child's blood test was over 100.
Objection.
And
it was a yes or no question.
And
Hold on. So the question was, do you recall reporting in 2020 or after the final parenting plan? Contacting CPS and reporting that the mother abused the child or children. Am I getting that correct?
Yes.
Okay. So you need to answer that question, whether you did or you did not.
I stated that the mother has over-medicalized the children in the past.
So is the answer yes or no then?
I did make the statement medical. Medicalizing.
Did you also make reports about my mental health?
I'm sorry, one more time.
Did you also make reports about my mental health?
Is that on this page?
Withdrawn. It may or may not be, and we're not there yet. I'd like to request Exhibit 330, which was admitted on the report of Dr. Delatour.
I
that Dr. Delatour testified about your making multiple reports since 2009 about my mental health?
No, can you refresh my memory?
Yes. She notes in her report at page 3. That I completed an evaluation by Dr. Trous based on your claims that I was suicidal? Is that correct?
This is your mental health evaluation. I have no idea what you guys talked about. I can't make comment on your mental health.
You read the report, correct?
I can't make comment on your mental health. Your report.
Objection, unresponsive.
So I think that his is actually an objection, that the there is an objection called the document speaks for itself, and so that is the appropriate objection, in that he's only familiar with this document because it was offered and it is as an exhibit. It doesn't mean that he has any further knowledge of it than that. So the document speaks for itself. It's appropriate, and I will accept the objection based upon that.
Okay.
Sustained. You can address it, but whether it says something or doesn't say something, it's really not in his wheelhouse.
So the second sentence in that paragraph, this evaluation was ordered as Mr. Knight had alleged that she was suicidal and should not have contact with her children. Is that what it states?
If that's what you read, it must state that.
Do you recall making allegations that I was suicidal and should not have contact with the children?
Ms. Voss, this is the narrative of your psychologist.
Objection.
Yeah. And so he just answered the question. She asked, do you recall whether you made such a report or reports?
I do not recall.
Do you recall the dependency case commencing based on your report that I was medically abusing the children?
No, I remember it commencing because Dr. Wiester's report went to CPS and they called me up and said, you have to get your butt down to court right now today. And it commenced. I remember that. I don't remember me doing it. I remember that it was from Dr. Wiester's report stating that she had done a year-long investigation and her findings was that you were doing medical child abuse. That's what started it.
You don't recall calling Child Protective Services and reporting?
I remember making a complaint to Child Protective Services about you over-medicalizing my children because you was taking my children to the doctor 50 times in 1 year and it was in court. And when it was investigated, it was found to be true, and Dr. Wiester, who is the director of Child Protective Services for Seattle Children's Hospital, did her investigation and made the report, and CPS called me up and told me to come to court because my kids were going to be taken away if I didn't show up.
And so that would be a yes. You called CPS and that prompted Dr. Wiester's report?
Yes.
And so you had no objection to Dr. Wiester's report in ER 904s. Is that correct?
It would fall under limine, but if you want to put that bad report on there for yourself, you can go right ahead.
And isn't it true that her report follows almost word for word your report to Child Protective Services.
I have no idea.
And in the current case, you've made reports to Child Protective Services, you've made reports to medical providers, you've made reports to the court. And I've abused or neglected the children. Is that correct?
I have concerns on the way that you treat my children, yes. And some of the points do come to the point where I believe you are psychologically abusing my children, yes.
And so if there were no basis to your allegation that about suicide, and I believe, let's just confirm that that exhibit was entered. I see that 306 was entered. Was 305 admitted?
Yes, 305 was admitted.
Okay. And 306 as well.
That's true.
And three oh seven was not.
That is true.
And 309 was as exhibit 215.
I do see that 215 was admitted, and I won't comment on whether it's the same as another document.
Sure.
But I'll accept your,
of course,
your rendition.
Of
you
course.
Seem to understand these things.
Okay. And I'm sorry, previously when Dr. De La Tour was talking about the CPS records, I'm sorry, we may have created that muddled record situation here, because she was looking at exhibit 310 when she indicated that she used these records in her report and evaluation.
Okay, well, what we have is what we have.
And so I'd like to offer 310.
310.
Is 310 the same as another document?
That is my understanding. Let's check and make sure.
310 is equal to what?
17? Yes.
And 17 has not been admitted either.
Correct. I didn't want to offer it until I
okay.
had... certain the record will reflect that Dr. De La Tour testified that she looked at all of these CPS records in her report and evaluation and her testimony.
Are you offering?
I'm sorry, I think.
I'm just sitting here waiting, and I'm sorry if I didn't realize that, okay.
Maybe you're offering
310?
I was offering 310.
Okay.
Correct.
Mr. Knight, did you give him the 310?
No.
Okay.
I did not.
Well, we go to, let's accomplish that, is get the 310 and give it to Mr. Knight, find out whether he objects to it, and then we'll be back on track. Okay, so there are documents in 310. I want you to take a look at those documents, Mr. Knight. And those documents are being offered right now for to be admitted. And I want to know whether you object to that.
Yeah.
And then we'll go from there.
Objection, Your Honor. Ms. Voss just married a couple of current papers at the back of the file, so she can bring up the 2009 forward. It's 11 years old, and she's trying to attach it to 2020 documentation. It's res judicata. It's in limine.
I want to start with the foundational issues.
Okay.
How? What's the foundation for these documents to come in? They're hearsay documents, and so you need to give me the exception to the hearsay rule.
Well, Dr. Delatour testified, and her report indicates, her notes, that she relied on these CPS reports in her evaluation and report. Dr. Langer also indicated that these were among the collaterals he considered in his evaluation and treatment of me.
Just a moment.
They relate to Dr. McCollum's evaluation of me and Dr. Delatour's evaluation as well. And again, on res judicata, does not bar a suit even if it involves the same course of wrongful conduct as alleged earlier, so long as the suit alleges new facts or worsening of the earlier condition. Again, citing Lawler versus National Screen Service Corporation. And there are new facts in Mr. Knight's continuing this behavior of getting around the court process by using other authorities, child protective services, medical providers, etc., so that he doesn't have to do the work of taking me to court. He's utilized these agencies to come after me so that it's this David versus Goliath situation again and again. Many claims about my mental health, many false claims about my abusing the children, getting other people to carry his water. And that pattern of behavior has been the most destructive element our family has known. It continues, and it's a worsening condition that is absolutely impacting the mental health of our children.
So she's testifying.
if it helps, I have an additional exhibit to further make this point clear.
Well, I understand your, I understand the relevance issue that you're trying to address. So additional exhibit or evidence doesn't, I don't think addresses that issue. I got to figure out, because you offered this as a 904, and there was a response to it that said, objections from 2009 to 2014, no objection to 2020 records from Mr. Knight. But I still have to consider whether these are records under 904, and they're similar to that of a police report. Police reports, it's clear in the case law, police reports cannot be brought in as a 904. You are asserting, however, and your basis for admission is that these were documents relied upon by two treatment providers in fashioning your treatment program and analyzing or determining your diagnosis. And so it's, they're not medical records for the purposes of like a medical chart and those type of things, but I'm just looking right now to find out whether that reaches that exception. I'm not sure it does.
I
inherent problem whenever a exhibit is being offered subsequent to testimony. In other words, at the time the testimony is given, the court has a better opportunity of understanding the basis for the request for admission. We are dealing with a witness who testified many weeks ago. And Ms. Voss, what you are attempting to do is rely upon her testimony that she looked at these as a basis that these are statements for medical diagnosis or treatment. And looking at something doesn't get you there. Specifically, what has to occur is that there was a diagnosis, and certainly that there was a diagnosis by this medical provider. That in order to achieve that diagnosis, the provider relied upon a document. While I do recall the document being reviewed by the provider, I don't recall the testimony where that provider said that she relied upon this document for the purposes of making the diagnosis. And I would be surprised if that's the case. And so I need to have you point me to when she would have said such a thing. And what I'd be looking for is the date of the testimony and the time period of the testimony, if you have that available. Court does not get even to the issue of the motion in limine until you have satisfied the foundation issues.
Dr. Delatour testified on March 22nd.
Okay, just a moment now. I'll get to March 22nd. Which is the first day of trial?
Yes.
Okay. Do you have an approximate time period?
According to the record, I was given at 2:28. She identified Exhibit 310.
Okay, I do. I see the same thing. So she testified that those were true and correct copies reviewed.
Correct. And that she used them in her evaluation. I thought for sure it was
okay,
in this
right
report.
There. She does say that she relied upon these CPS documents for her assessment. Okay, so you have crossed the bridge of foundation. Now we have the motion in limine of those documents that were that occurred, that were created prior to the 2017, and your argument on that was that, one more time, your argument on that.
That the res judicata includes, it does not bar the worsening of earlier condition as long as there are new facts. And we have new facts of reports that are ongoing that are causing problems for the children. And
objection, Your Honor.
Just let me finish hearing from her, then you'll have your objection. Go ahead.
This is a long-standing problem that has harmed our family. To only look at the vacuum of one portion of this problem, I just hate for this court to repeat the same mistake that the 2017 court made in not looking at the big picture. And this is simply...
And I'm gonna respond to that, because I sense that with Dr. Langer's testimony, that the evidence being provided was evidence that the 2017 court got it wrong. And that is not a consideration of this court, or nor can it be. Okay. And you touched on that again, and I want to make sure that everybody's on the same page on this, that this court cannot go back and say 2017 is wrong, we're going to fix it. What this court looks to is what happened after 2017. I understand your vacuum issue, in that it's really a context issue, that this court can't analyze something that happens today unless, as it being an issue, unless contextually you know the history, and I get that argument. And to some degree, the court has allowed things, such as the McCollum and the other, and Dr. Linger's reference to McCollum and whoever that, one prior to McCollum, who did a evaluation. Okay, I understand all those arguments. And Mr. Knight, your response. If you have it.
Ms. Voss has simply been trying to retry the 2017 hearing the whole dang time.
Okay.
That's the reason why we have so much paperwork here. If we were actually to the basis of her amended petition, 90% of this paperwork would be gone and we would be over this trial. It would have been done days ago. I have been stating from the very beginning that Ms. Voss is just trying to relitigate. This is just proof that it's just a relitigation. She don't approve of the way the parenting plan came out in 2017, and she has her psychologist saying the same thing. I have to receive the brunt of her attacks because she don't agree with that. I'm still in objection to going over the stuff from previous of 2017. I'm accepting the fact that the courts are going to be on Ms. Voss's side and allow her to attack me until she is finished attacking me. But I want the rules to at least stay in place for that I don't have to be rejudicated on every issue every time. I've explained these issues to thousands of people over the years, and I just want to go home and be left alone.
If I may clarify,
the court's going to admit 310 on a limited basis. In other words, the limited basis is that this was a series of documents relied upon by Dr. Dillator in her assessment of Ms. Voss.
My other objection is, if Ms. Voss wanted this in, put in at that time, she should have done it when she had her on the stand. Why are we coming back and rehashing it to extend the court out? She is getting away with way more than she should be.
Mr. Knight, that's enough. And so the court has to follow the rules of evidence. Whether the foundation occurs contemporaneously with the request or happens previously to the request, the court has to always consider the foundation that was presented to the court. Fortunate for the court's analysis is that the court's notes clearly show that Dr. Latour relied upon these for an assessment. However, utilized these documents in asking Mr. Knight further questions goes beyond the scope of this being admitted. In other words, the court recognizes Dr. De La Torre reviewed documents, and these are some of the documents that Dr. De La Torre reviewed. And that is the extent of how these are admitted. Okay. To the extent that the assessments considered evidence prior to the court's order, that's going to be a matter of argument in closing argument. Okay. So, 310 is admitted. You may proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor. Have you been received any instructions historically as to where the proper place for these sorts of disagreements lie? These sorts of disagreements being specifically allegations that I'm abusing or neglecting the children. Have you received prior instruction or information directing where to take these concerns?
I'm not understanding your question.
Is Child Protective Services or the court or providers?
If I have a concern about the safety of my children, I will go to any and every agency that I possibly can to protect my children. I don't care if it's against the mother or the courts or whatever. I'm going to make sure my children are safe. And if I have to go to CPS or if I have to go somewhere else, I will do that.
It's 3:30. We're going to take our afternoon recess. I'll start up again at 3:41.